Board of Appeals hearing to order. Thanks, everybody, for being here. I'm gonna go ahead and read the public notice. Tonight, we're here on a continuation of a public hearing in the Great Room at the Pleasant Street Center, 49 Pleasant Street, Reading, Mass., Thursday, November 10th at 7 p.m., 2016, on the petition of MKM Reading LLC, who seeks a comprehensive permit to develop 72 units of rental housing on approximately 42,342 square feet of residentially zoned land under MGL Chapter 40B, Sections 20 to 23, with waivers from zoning requirements on the property located at 3141 Lincoln Street and 212 Prescott Street in Reading, Massachusetts. Little insight on how we think tonight's meeting is going to go. We'll give a brief overview of the board process and where we're going with this application, some of the timing issues. We'll turn it over to the applicant to provide an overview of any updates or changes to plans. We've received some new plans and some updated information as recently as within the past few days, I think. The board then is, there's been posted on the site and provided to the applicant a rough draft of a decision on this petition. And the board intends, and we'd ask also for, when the public comment section is open, if folks want to speak to who have seen a copy of the draft decision, to weigh in on that. I would ask, there are a number of obviously familiar faces tonight. We've heard an awful lot of public comment and thoughtful comment from our residents on this application. I'd like to try to ask, if at all possible, if you've spoken before and raised your concerns before, that you try to confine your remarks tonight to the draft decision or any new concerns that you might have regarding new information that's been provided. The board has, and the minutes reflect, and the record reflects, a number of thoughtful, well-placed comments by residents, and we do have those and are taking those into consideration, as is the applicant. Once we're through with public comment, we'll give the board some opportunity to discuss some next steps. The next date for the hearing on this application, and it should be noted that at this point, the hearing date, we think that a hearing date of December 15th is the actual outside date, because as the process stands right now, December 15th is the date that this hearing must close without a further agreement between the board and the applicant. So let me give you a little bit. So that's how I expect the meeting to transpire tonight. Those providing public comment, hopefully you've had a chance to sign in, please, and let us know that you're here. If you're going to speak before the board tonight, please direct your comments to the board, identify yourself and your address so that our secretary can make sure that we know who you are and what you've had to say, and please keep all remarks civil and on point, if you would, and we all appreciate that. So going on to the agenda, the board has had meetings since February 4th, which was the date that this hearing opened on this application. We've had a couple of extensions of time. The applicant has provided some information. We've agreed on some extensions to process that information, engage in peer review, engage in feedback from the applicant on the application. As of today, again, we have a rough draft of a decision that we're going to talk about, the applicant's going to talk about, you're going to talk about, so that we can get it right. While the application is met with some comments and concerns, we want to make sure that we put the best decision that we can together to benefit the town, to benefit the applicant, and to put a sound decision in keeping with Chapter 40B together. So with that, I would like to turn the process, to turn the hearing over to the applicant to perhaps provide any updates on information and any overviews that the applicant would like to share with the board.
Good evening, thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, town officials, and the audience, Matthew Zugrim, Dan Redding. Very minor changes since the last time we were here, but I'll just go through a couple of them. Most of them had to do with the civil plans. There was a couple of adjustments, such as like adding roof leaders on the plan for parts of the mansard roof. Updating things, we had my engineer had a meeting with Redding Light on October 24th, so made some changes to that, discussed some things on how poles would work and those type of things, so there's a couple of changes on that. Our engineer went out and inspected the sewer main on October 24th, and there's a letter we submitted that shows, October 24th, that shows the results of what he found. I think there's something from the town engineer that came in today that substantiated and agreed with his conclusions and what he said. And we also did a fire flow test on a hydrant, and the results were there, so we're going to fight on that. There was a comment from the fire chief to add a fire hydrant on Lincoln Street, so that obviously still has to get added, but that would be based on some discussion between the chief and the engineer. On the landscape plan, there were some comments that we heard from the board and some other comments last time. We kind of redid the front a little bit, added a little hardscape, and put a bench or two in, and then showed the plan with hardier plants on the back where the snow removal areas are. If I have the clicker, it's about I could probably highlight some of those. Thank you.
Sure.
Some more like hardscape up here and put a couple benches in at the front just as a feature, and then the plantings back here and so we will use the hardier plants. We submitted a picture of one of those that he was there. I don't know the actual plant name of it. I did have it up on my phone a second ago, but it was the Carpinus metaphyllus astina, and it's just a plant that looks like an evergreen, but it's hardy in terms of you can put snow along its base. So we submitted a picture of that along with the revised landscape plan. That just, you know, those were basically the changes we made. We also are going Tuesday night to the selectmen to go over the surface zones. I think the best route will go to them. I think maybe the best route in terms of getting their approval on it, since, you know, it falls into a gray area, but that's probably just the best course of action, as well as talk about some other ideas for parking downtown and some other, begin that discussion with them on that. So we'll go in there Tuesday evening, so there you go.
Thanks.
So again, all the other plans, we put them in one package for you, otherwise they haven't changed, the architectural hasn't changed. The engineer changed for those four or five changes. So that's it for now. So thank you, guys.
Thank you. I think our time is best spent tonight. The board has had an opportunity to review the draft decision that's been put together, and an updated list of waivers. And while that hasn't been, I don't think, completely compiled in the draft decision, we've, I think, got between the waivers and the draft decision, I think, enough information for the board to provide general and specific feedback on how they'd like to see or areas that we would potentially, the board would potentially condition for and/or just general commentary. So I think without further ado, I'm gonna start down at the end with Eric. I'm sorry, with Nick. Sorry, with Nick. Sorry, you guys might have switched seats. With Nick, and Nick, go ahead, have at it.
All right, I just have a couple of questions. One was about the trash. The trash, my understanding is going to be stored inside, and then when the trash pickup comes, they physically can go into the building and then take it out, so it won't actually be on the street pile.
Yeah, the intention is a compactor that you would put, it's a chute and a compactor, and there's throwaway bins in there that they attach to, and they would get rolled out when it was stopped by the pickup company when they had to pick it up.
So trash won't be on the sidewalk?
It's not a storage, no. It will be taken out when it's ready to be picked up, whether by the company itself or the management company. There actually are little trucks now that would fit in this building, believe it or not, but my guess is more likely it will be rolled out when it's time to be, when they come to pick it up.
And do you have an update as to off-street parking, if you made any progress on identifying any spots if that's needed?
We have on-street parking there. We have a plan that shows the two service zones in the front for loading, unloading, and whatnot. And the same amount of spaces now as before, and we're going Tuesday to the selectmen to talk about that specifically, as well as begin discussions. We've had in smaller group discussions, but begin discussions with the whole board of selectmen on ideas of better use of downtown parking.
That's all I have.
Thank you. Si?
Yeah. I'm a little frustrated at this point. We're here at a point in the process where we're reviewing a decision, draft decision. On the site configuration that, to me, is not much different than what we started with on February 4th. But it appears to be the configuration of choice. In my view, it has done little to address the major concerns raised by the community and the board. And I'm thinking specifically of density. I'm thinking specifically of parking and safety. The number of units has not been reduced by very much. The number of parking spaces have virtually been unchanged. And I think with the acquisition of the gas station property, there was a golden opportunity there to put together a really beautiful piece of property on this lot, which could have significantly impacted those concerns, left us with a facility that would be much more easily acceptable and still be economically feasible. I'm disappointed as to where we are at the end of 10 months, and I just have to say that, okay, at the end. All right, I just have to say that. We are here, we're doing a decision. I have a lot of, as we get into the meat of the decision, I have a lot of questions to raise. But parking and density and the safety of the area, and a lot of the other things, loading, unloading, snow removal, trash removal, those are all issues that we have not put our hands around yet, that we need to put our hands around this thing in whatever decision we make, this one or any other. And I'm just going to leave it at that for the moment.
Thank you, Si. Kathy?
I agree with Si in terms of my frustration in this process. I do think that the parking is still a concern. And I guess a question I would have is, do you have any data or anything else that can speak to the justification for one parking space per unit in this location? So that would be a question at some point for myself that I would just like, because I think there's a lot of people here from the community that would really like an answer to that. A lot of people that are here on a daily basis commuting in and out of Boston and who see that there's a problem already, and it's just something that you add a new apartment building in here, and I know you say, oh, well, you could go park somewhere else in the town. I just don't see the feasibility of that or how that's actually going to work. And then some other concerns that I think that we do need to address is that even during construction, a good plan during construction as to where all these vehicles will be parking, what's going to happen to the vehicles that park here now. It's going to be an upheaval for the people that live here in this community, and I do think that it's something that needs to be addressed. And the other question I had is, when these units are marketed, are they going to be marketed as coming with one parking space? And then how are they going to be told about visitor parking? I think those are all things that we're going to have to address. And then the last question I had was about lighting. It doesn't sound like there's a lot of lighting in the back of the building, which I think may be good for the people that are living behind it. And I don't know, like, in terms of going forward, what the plan is in terms of safety behind the building. That's another thing that I think has to be addressed. You know, keep in mind the neighbors, but also safety. So I still do have some real concerns about this. That's all I have for right now.
Would the applicant like an opportunity to speak to those specific issues, or would you like to wait to hear collectively what the board has to say? Why don't we let the board continue and then keep track of it? You may hear some of those again. Thanks, Kathy. Eric?
I think that, you know, with the actual minutia of it, it's easy to kind of get lost in what variety of ground cover we're going to use, and what flow rates and, you know, hydrodynamics are at work here. And for that, I can only rely on the peer experts that we have and the data back and forth. And there seems to be some general agreement about the mechanics of it. But looking back, you know, to our initial conversations, probably across the board here, density is going to be the issue. And I'm wondering specifically, since you do have a meeting with the Board of Selectmen set up, you must have a proposal. I know you've mentioned some conversations, and we've kind of hinted at it, and you know, we have notes in the file that applicants is exploring options, but you must have a proposal that you're bringing to the board, or at least a rough one. I know that hearing is not until Tuesday, and I will certainly be there in attendance, but maybe you could just humor us with some specifics that you're kicking around, just so that we have a chance to comment on this before our next meeting on the 15th. And then the only other thing is, I saw in the draft opinion that we have, maybe I'm reading it wrong, but maybe a small inconsistency with the number of parking spaces. I saw 72, and then I saw, so 72 parking spaces is in unit, sorry, paragraph 9, and then paragraph D parking says that there'll be 73. So I just wanted to just point that out and just clarify with you guys what the final number is. That's it.
Thanks, sir. John.
And maybe just to pick up what Eric had mentioned, one of the plans that you provided us tonight, we saw just for the first time, going over with Rob, there's one plan that's it says 74 parking spaces. So we have 72, 73, and 74. So maybe a clarification on that. staying on just the parking spaces for a second, are we talking about assigned parking spaces? Are we talking about first come, first serve? Who's going to be doing the policing, especially during the winter months when parking and snow removal and just access to the building becomes an issue? There seems to be a number of issues here that have not been nailed down. I guess I have some frustrations too, like Cy. In the previous 40Bs that I've sat on, the board doesn't have all the expertise. It relies on the community. It relies on the daytime government specialists, such as the Public Works Department, on the infrastructure of the water and sewage. And in the letter that was sent, I see that it appears that they still have not digested all the materials that they have. So when we're sitting here trying to finalize a draft decision, you have to have something to refer to. Right now, we don't seem to have all of that stuff nailed down. And as one board member, I'm a little bit concerned that in that decision, which is going to be a multitude of pages, that there needs to be something in there. One thing we certainly have not talked about is under the construction, as you take down these three structures that sit there now, and you start doing the infrastructure for the building, how is that all going to work? We have not addressed any of that, yet it has to go into the, in my mind, it needs to go into the final draft or the decision itself. Another area that was mentioned also is you have a meeting, or we have a meeting, I guess it's we, have a meeting with the selectmen come next Tuesday night. I guess I was looking for some clarification on the loading zones. Where does that final decision lie? With this board or with the, and that's not only the number of loading docks, loading zones, but where they're located. Where does that fall? As just one member of the board, I said the last time we met, 72 units or rental units, having a loading zone on, I think it was Lincoln Street, on a major thoroughfare, with 72 people just initially moving in, forget about that, but further down the road when you have new people coming in and people who have rented before moving out, you're going to have to give parking priorities to people who are moving in and what times, and how do you control all of that stuff? Because right across the street, I mean, yes, in the morning, early in the morning, there's not going to be anybody there. Early in the morning, everybody's going to be taking spaces, or later in the afternoon, coming back and leaving their spaces. But in between, what happens on Saturdays? What happens on Sundays? All of that, to me, means that any loading zone needs to be on site. It does not need to be on town-owned property, impacting traffic and parking spaces. So there's a couple in here that I see have changed, as well as the number of parking spaces too. So I see a lot of things that need to be nailed down. And my concern is that if we don't nail them down by the 15th, we're going to be in trouble. And I'm talking about the next meeting, because we could be here on the 15th until 2 in the morning on the 16th trying to nail down all this stuff, and it still may not be done. So my question is to the rest of the board and to town council here is, number one, where is that final determination on loading zones? And number two, you're helping to write this final draft decision. So where does that put you? I know we have 45 days, but if we can't nail it all down within two meetings, where are we going? Tonight is not, in my mind, tonight is not going to be sufficient to nail down everything that's on this draft. We just don't have the information, in my mind. I'll stop right there.
Chris, you want to jump in?
Yep, I can jump in on that. Chris Heap, Town Council. The question came up at the last session of the hearing as to if the applicant was proposing to put the service, the loading zones on the in the public street, who would have the authority to approve or not approve that, mm-hmm. that question. I've looked at it since, and the general rule is that when acting on a 40B application, this board stands in the shoes of all local boards in town. That's usually defined very broadly and usually means just about everybody else in town. But most commonly that is applicable to permits that the applicant needs to use its own property to develop its own property, whereas now we're talking about the applicant making use of the town's right of way. I can't find any specific support for the idea that if we're talking about granting some kind of exclusive use of the town right of way, that this board can do that. And I think, having looked at it extensively, I think the better answer is that approval ought to remain with the Board of Selectmen. So this board can certainly consider whether it's a good idea or not to have it in this room. But the question of who would actually approve that, I think that would go to the Selectmen. On the question of the amount of work that remains to be done on the decision, I completely agree. I don't know that, certainly wouldn't suggest that the decision needs to get done or even close to done tonight. I think there, in my experience working on these decisions, takes an awfully long time. And I would contemplate that it would take several, at least one, if not several additional sessions of hearing to get the decision into final shape. So I think tonight, in terms of looking at the decision, ought to be the first step in a longer process. And also would want to point out that the board is obligated currently to close the hearing by December 15th, but it will have an additional 40 days after that to continue deliberating and working on its final decision. So this board, after December 15th, this board can keep talking among itself, keep talking to town council and to staff to as much as needed. It's really only on December 15th, the only thing that really happens is we cease being able to take in additional information from the public and from outside consultants and from the applicant. I mean, so there's an additional window of time to think about what the board wants to do and commit that to writing after December 15th.
Would I be correct in assuming that you would be at that meeting next Tuesday evening?
Yes.
Anything else, John?
No, nothing. Yes,
Robert?
Okay. Rather than being redundant, Peter, I pretty much agree with my fellow board members there. I think the parking, we've gone through this since last February, woefully inadequate for the number of units you're putting in there. Well, on that much more, I agree absolutely with John. I don't think that loading zone at all should be on a public street. It should be on private property for the exclusive use of those residents, period. That's it. And some of the other things on the waivers that I look at is, when we talk about open space on there, and they mentioned 22% open space. I haven't gone through with a planimeter or anything like that measuring it out, but I look at this landscape plan and I find it really hard to comprehend that there's 22% of the lot area is open space. Maybe you consider the parking lot under the building where the building overlaps it as open space. I don't consider that open space. I consider the planting areas it would be open, and that is certainly. I look at this landscape plan, I see no open space available for the residents for any type of recreation. Sitting out, taking a walk around, anything like that. There's just no room in there. There's no green areas on this area. As I was going through the waivers, one waiver I see that was asked for is to allow for an unusually shaped lot. Maybe before you obtained the Brown property, it was unusually shaped, you would have considered it. But I don't consider this an unusually shaped lot now. It's a corner lot, period. You're asking for a waiver on drive aisles from a 26 foot that the town typically requires, so the bylaws require. Down to say 23, 24. I would be hard pressed to go anything less than 24 feet for a drive aisle on that. And other than, you know, that's, rather than be, as I say, redundant with some of the other comments that have been made, I will leave it at that right now.
You know, my thoughts stem almost entirely from areas that we've gotten feedback from daytime government where there is still some, perhaps, information required to make an informed decision. You know, certainly, I know we've asked for, the town has asked for justification for parking ratios and visitor parking, management of that operation and those areas. We still don't have that. You know, whether or not this board believes an off-site loading area is on town land is feasible is another matter. Whether or not the Board of Selectmen believe it's feasible and or advisable, we'll have an opportunity to hear whether that's the case on Tuesday. We've heard from our from public safety officials regarding some lighting issues, and I think we ought to make sure that the applicant addresses those, especially on the rear of the building. You know, as far as the waivers go, you know, I know there are still discussions to be had. There are still talking points that need to be hammered out, but you know, there are going to be some conditions in this decision, especially as they relate to parking, and so those discussions probably have to come sooner rather than later so that we don't butt heads on those issues any further. And I think justification for the parking ratios is going to be necessary, but I still think the town is going to hold the applicant to something more than what's there right now. And again, those are discussion points, and certainly can be the subject of a mutual agreement. In terms of the request for waivers, you know, the use regulations and table of dimensional controls, you know, those are issues that I think may have already been hashed out. Robert brings up a good point on the configuration of the lot that may no longer be an issue, and perhaps these waiver requests need to be updated before the board can fully address them. Are we still looking at 61 bedroom, 3 2 bedroom, 9 3 bedroom units? Is that the present still stuck with? I know there was some question as to whether or not that might change, but as we sit here today, that's where it is.
Yes.
Okay. And again, we just got some revised plans today that I'm sure that we're going to have to look at as well. But in the meantime, you know, I'm not gonna beat to death what's already been discussed by the other board members, other than to suggest that that I support much of what the board has suggested today. You know, a lot of this has been suggested before, so it can't be a surprise to anyone, including the applicant. And with that, I'd like to open up the public comment period and ask again. You're right. Before we do that, the applicant's been, I'm sure, taking notes and would like an opportunity to provide some feedback to what the board has, issues that the board has raised. So I'll give you that opportunity and that privilege.
Thank
please.
You. I'll try to be quick, but I'll just go over. When I know the 40B process can always be frustrating for everyone. I've all been through it before. There's two obviously issues we've been hearing, parking and density. We submitted a couple months ago a summary of that waiver request that, amongst other things, referenced the lengthy report that the town had prepared in 2010, I believe, about downtown parking. I didn't write the report. I could only tell you it recommended a maximum of one space per unit. You could disagree with it or not, but that's just what it says. Two, I think it's lost that the majority of our units are one-bedroom units. There is a different demand on it. It's a proven fact that, you know, ones are going to have a different demand than twos and threes. So we've kept it more ones. So, you know, when you start switching that ratio, it could start switching the parking, but we're confident in our parking ratio. I also cited in there the model transit-oriented development bylaw that the state puts out that recommends one space. I referenced about four projects in there, a couple in Beverly and Quincy, but, you know, they were all recent, either just approved or just built. That was one per unit. I could reference more. You could always find ones more in the city, but I was trying to find, like, Beverly ones that were in similar areas. We talked to Haven Street about their parking. Their ratio is 1.25, and some of those spaces are commercial spaces, and they don't think that they don't even always use their spaces. So, and we were asked to talk to them from the town, and we did. So you may disagree with what we put in that summary, but we have provided that information. It's just as important to us from a business standpoint that the parking ratio works. And there also is, when you build something, if people know that the max they could have is one and they have to have two, they won't live there. I mean, it's common in plenty of places when there's something there that they need that's not there, they do have other choices. It's not the only place that you can move. But being next to the train station, I think, is kind of, we are, if not the closest building would be to the train station, it doesn't get much closer. So any parking discussions we had with the peer review consultants, and when we gave numbers, they didn't even take into effect the amount of train usage that we expect people would be there. Obviously, there's no, you know, there's services downtown, but so there's a need for a car, but we are confident, based on all that, the recommendations in the report and everything else we have, that one is an appropriate number there. Again, it's our opinion, and it's just from gathering the data we pulled together. Density, before we acquired the corner piece, we were 93 units an acre. After we acquired the corner piece, we were about 73 units an acre. It's a substantial, and you could look at density plenty of different ways. There's, you know, square footage, units, bedrooms, but just from the unit count, that's a, you know, over a 20% reduction just there in density. And that was, you know, we got another piece. So we lowered the floor. So I think that getting that corner piece did present and gave us the opportunity to design something that was a better building, and we believe we did. But we also, it is considerably less dense than it was before. Those are the two big issues that, I mean, we've heard a lot about. Plenty of other good topics, construction management, demo and all that stuff is kind of, that whole series of items are things that have to get figured out. And it's really technical beyond probably the board scope and our scope, but something you do with the building department, DPW, the police. I mean, there's a whole process that you condition out that construction management plans have to get approved. Demolition plans have to get approved. There's got to be rules that have to be followed. And the, you know, the appropriate boards who deal with that on a daily basis is where I feel that it's appropriate to hash out the very technical details of that stuff. But it's important. It has to get taken care of. The, you know, lighting in the rear is another one that we're, our engineers and our architects are confident that we have lighting. We definitely have it all the exit and entrances to the building, and we have it to where we feel it's safe for our building. You know, we could add a little more in the back. We don't think we need to, but it's not like we're saying no. We just think that having less is better for the neighbors, and if we get it to the point where we feel it's safe in the back, then we're kind of at that happy medium, but it's not something we're adverse to, you know, looking at. And then there was a point about the drive aisles. Those are 24, as was recommended by the town and the engineer peer review and the traffic peer review. So it is 24. It's the 26, so we asked for a waiver of 24. And then, you know, there's a lot of other, we'll go Tuesday. I think the service zone is a good thing. I Again, we're creating curbing on that street where there was none now, which will create additional ability for on-street parking. So we will be providing, it essentially will be the same amount that's there, and we just felt that right in front of the building, from a practical standpoint, closest to the elevators is the appropriate place to put that. We designed it so it would be off the street, and the town peer review consultant didn't think that was a good way because it was difficult. So we, instead of trying to enforce the issue, we thought the best issue was just let's curb the street and put it right in front, and maybe as a designated service zone, whether it's for use in other properties around there. We'll have that discussion with the selectmen Tuesday. Ideas, someone asked about downtown parking. Clearly there's lots of spaces, so, I think it's a pretty basic, how do we use these spaces off hours to provide parking for, whoever maybe, not just our building, but other visitors to the area. So I think there's opportunity. It's just more procedurally, how do you accomplish something like that? Especially in like the winter months with snow removal and all that. There's some lots in town now that are, you could park there overnight all year, but what's the logistics of making, say, the parking right across the street, parking that could be utilized, overnight all year. So it's more logistics with, DPW and procedurally with the selectmen is that, how do they, we go about doing that. But I think clearly there's a insufficient use of parking downtown between the daytime use and the nighttime use. And I think that the town tries to grow downtown, which is great, a great downtown, that figuring out how to better utilize some of that is a beneficial thing. Back to the parking, we had submitted that, so it wasn't like we hadn't. So if there was something more than that, I'm not sure what that would be, but we've looked at it at length just from a business standpoint and from a waiver request point. So I think I covered most of the comments, unless there was a specific one maybe I missed.
Thank you. You brought up a proposed solution regarding one car. Perhaps one car per unit. How do you enforce that? How do you intend to enforce that?
I think it's most likely it's a space, you pay, it's a little less rent than you pay to rent that space. But I think, part of when you move into a building, every building has rules. It's a one space per unit building. But in the same sense, you may have 10 spaces that don't have any. Not out of the realm of possibility that they utilize other means of transportation, and that a three unit may use two. It's a self-governing thing that we're more than happy to, put it, somewhere. But it's more of a management on a yearly basis. I think there's a condition that an operation and management plan has to be provided and updated. So I think, in there is kind of, the work that, it change over time, and it may not change over time, but it's a limit of how many off-street parking spaces are in the building.
That one space per unit, the applicant would be amenable to a condition in the decision regarding that?
For that reason alone, so if, say you do a one space per unit condition, and 10 spaces aren't used, but 10 units don't have a space, and there's people that have an extra car that could use that space. I think that's kind of contrary because you're conditioned on the number of spaces you could have. Limiting it to that amount, there may be a better way to say it than just a flat one space per unit, because you may get into a condition where then you have unused spaces that could be used by someone in the building.
All right, so thank you. Thanks very much. All right, with that, I will now open the floor for public comment. And before I do that, I'd like to ask again, if you have something that you'd like to add. We've had a lot of thoughtful public comments. please identify yourself and address your comments to the board. If the applicant would like or feels the need to respond to that comments, we will give the applicant an opportunity to do that. Please raise your hand if you'd like to speak and wait to be recognized by me. And perhaps we can even hand around a microphone to help with that part of the process. With that, we're open for public comment. Would anybody like to speak?
Correct the memo that was put out '94, '96, and '03 exceeded the capacity of the sewer in the area by blowing the manhole covers off into his yard. That is not what I said. I have a turn at the back of my building. I live in an 1894 building. They could not make pipe go in a corner, so they had to put a turn, which is like a manhole out back. That manhole, when I came off from work, was the cover was floating a foot and a half off the ground from the water coming out of there. That's water from up the street because it's the capacity isn't taken. They quote that a 40-year veteran of the town couldn't remember the situation on the highway that. Well, by 05, they had done a survey of the dumping of sump pumps because that area couldn't take the sump pumps that were going into the wash tubs and toilets and et cetera in the area. And they said, other than for any potential extraordinary events, I consider putting 70 odd units an extraordinary event in that area. And if it can happen three times in 30 years, we've been there 34, that is not a 100-year equivalent control for voting in. I think that it's still a major issue, and therefore I consider that the results coming in from that, from their interpretations, were not correct. But that system cannot take that capacity down there for the other residents in the area uphill. And I am way uphill. I am setting 20 to 30 feet above what this price is. And then there's another 50 feet above me to get to the top of Prescott Street. So I think this is a big, big issue still. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Thank you. Jonathan Barnes. I live at 41 Pratt Street. I simply want to echo what my neighbors have said. And I have said the same thing at previous meetings as well. And I know you've asked that we not repeat ourselves. But I think it bears repeating, not only for the applicant, but also for the town, but more importantly for you. You're asking for input from people who are here, and I don't want you to think, and I don't speak for anybody else here, although I do want to say I'm a neighbor to this area. I'm a town meeting member that represents Precinct 5, which includes this area. It also includes the downtown area. I am also a member of the Historical Commission, and I want to point out that there are at least two properties, and there are far more than two properties in this area that are significantly historical in nature in this town, one of which is the Reading Depot, which is on the National Register of Historic Places, and the Parker Tavern, two of the most significant historical structures in the town of Reading, both of which would be affected by this project. I noted that the shadow study significantly increases some shadows across the street to the depot. And I mostly want to say to you, whether or not you hear from other people who are here tonight, I speak for myself, but I speak for, I think, other people. And I want you to hear that we support any support from the ZBA in reducing the scope and the mass and the bulk of this project in the manner in which my neighbor, Ms. Blodgett, has pointed out, or in any manner you see fit. There's been a lot of reference to the Haven Street residential units that have gone up in the downtown Smart Growth District. There's been a lot of reference to the parking meeting the downtown parking, and I acknowledge this is downtown or budding downtown. But I want to remind you, and I want to remind the applicant, this is not the downtown. This is not the business district, which is across the street. This is in fact a residential district, and our comments reflect the fact that the scope and the mass and the scale of this project is not in keeping with the character and identity of that residential neighborhood. I've said this before, particularly with respect to the waivers. The waivers are a significant, the request for the waivers are a significant deviation from the standards, the dimensional controls, the use controls that this town has established for what it wants that neighborhood to look like. And in every respect, this application seeks to expand that beyond what, clearly beyond those dimensional controls. That's why they're asking for the waivers. And I would suggest that it is beyond what is appropriate in virtually every respect. And I've said this before, but it bears repeating. The dimensional controls for apartments, the lot size, should be 100,000 square feet. This lot size, if I'm not mistaken, is now 42,931. That's less than half of what the town expects an apartment zoned neighborhood property should look like. The height dimensional controls are 35 feet. This request, I think I saw it, was at 48 feet. And that's far higher than the dimensional controls that this town expects its projects to look like in this residential neighborhood. The off-street parking clearly is far more than what is appropriate. Again, I remind the applicant, even if the downtown parking survey or review suggests one, that's in the downtown area. And the downtown area is significantly different than a residential area. And I would submit again that one parking space is not adequate. The maximum lot coverage that the town suggests is 25%. This is asking for, I believe, 57%. The reference before was to the open space, and I think you're right. Even at 22%, that's far inadequate. The side yard setback should be 20 feet. This is at most 15 feet. The front setback is 15 feet. This, I think, on Prescott Street is asking for 6.6. On Lincoln Street is asking for 4.4. The rear setback, it should be 20 feet. This is asking for, I believe, 13 feet. The lot shape, the purpose for the lot shape is to not allow for overdevelopment of lots in the town, and certainly in residential districts. All of the requests that this application is seeking they all go to the same thing. It is far too large, far too big, far too broad in scale for what is appropriate in that neighborhood, in this neighborhood. And I wholly endorse your rejecting those waiver requests and doing whatever you can to scale this project down to what would be more appropriate. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Jean Thomas is emailed my concerns, and I hope you all have a copy of that and share it also, because I've spoken before and some of these are repetitive. Thank you for speaking so articulately and intelligently to the real heart, the structure, the really important parts of this, the neighborhood and the structure itself. Thank you so much for preparing that. I'll just mention a couple of things that I've talked about before. The traffic pattern of Washington Street, Arlington Street, these are very little streets. So there's a big problem with the traffic patterns. Again, the water table, thank you for bringing that up. I live at the low end. I live very close to the Doucette building. And my house is 1860. I get water in the basement. I accepted that. In these big snows and in spring, the sidewalk floods. I make a boardwalk in front of my house, and the storm drain at the end of Prescott and Arlington is totally blocked up and overflowing, going back down the street. Supervision of the property upkeep in the long run. You know, people drop litter, things happen, and stuff blows around. So you're going to have someone supervising your own property, but please realize this many people, some of that stuff is going to float around and not be totally controlled. Remediation and safety of the takedown, the noise of the takedown, the parking of the construction workers, altering of the environment in terms of sun, but mostly emissions. An air quality effect. Thank you for taking these things seriously, because the results will fall on somebody, not just the neighbors, they'll fall on the town.
is there anybody else that would like to speak? Yes, sir.
My name is Robert Ayello. I live on 106 Prospect Street. You ready? I have my son owns a house on Washington Street, and my daughter owns a house on Prescott Street. And I drive that, you know, 4 or 5 times a day. Right now, when you drive down Prescott Street, the Browns service station is an open lot. You before you get to the intersection, you have the visual of cars that want to make a left turn or go straight, et cetera. You put a three-story building on the corner, you have no more visibility. I ride a bicycle as well as drive, and it's a hazard. You need traffic lights, you do major intersection for what's now just a stop sign. That's all.
Thank you. Yes, in the back.
Yeah, hi. My name's Peter Ravages. I own the building at 21 Prescott Street, which is practically across the street. And I think it's an outrageous thing to do, to put this building in our little neighborhood. Really, obviously, it doesn't fit. I want to thank the neighbors here. They have more information than I do about the numbers. And I want to thank the board for putting up some opposition to this, because it really does not fit in the neighborhood. I think the proper solution is to make this one story less. That would solve almost every issue. And I think it would, it'd still be too big, but I think it's something that we could maybe get away with and live with. So that's why I have to say thank you.
Thank you. Would any other folks like to speak? Okay, I'm gonna close the public portion of the hearing, and we will now ask for, I'll ask any members of the board if they'd like to make any further comments related to the application prior to any further discussion about what our next steps are. Si?
Well, you've heard the comments, and it kind of reinforces what I was alluding to in my opening remark earlier. I personally don't see how you can, I still say parking is a serious issue. I don't know how you can solve the parking issue. I really don't know how you can solve the parking issue with the configuration you have now. I don't think you can do it. And when I put my initial thoughts together, I was thinking, and I tend to lean in the direction of a couple of the comments, if you reduced that building by one story, you could do wonders. You could. That would reduce the project to probably something like, I'm going to say, 48 to 50 units still. Would solve your parking ratio problem easily and create opportunity for visitor parking within the facility. You could also, by so doing, raise the height of the garage a little bit, maybe enough to accommodate loading and unloading. Drop off, pick up, whatever. There's a lot of things you could do that would have made this entire discussion acceptable to everybody. But we're here looking at a draft decision, which frankly I find very difficult to accept as a member of this board, because it does not solve the parking problem. It does not really solve the density problem, because in my view it's just as dense as it was before, maybe slightly better, but still unacceptably. And then a lot of these other issues that have been brought up, you know, to talk about the construction thing. No matter what you do in this facility, whether it's 3 stories, 4 stories, it's the construction is going to be a problem, and you got to go through that. You got to do it. It's temporary. You almost got to live with it, whatever it is. And it's going to be an inconvenience to everybody to do that. So I'm not hung up over that part of the process. That goes with the territory. I have a problem with loading and unloading on the street. I don't think there should be loading and unloading on the street. It should be within the facility. I don't think there should be any parking on the street other than residential parking. I think any parking related to the facility should be within the facility. If that's residents, visitors, whatever. Okay? So there are some issues here that we gotta get through. And I know we gotta walk through this process. I mean, to get a decision made on this project, and whatever the draft decision ends up being, it's gonna take a while. We may be having many, many meetings here before we get to an acceptable final draft. But I just have to say that. It's very difficult for me to support this project in its current configuration. And I have to go on record of saying that right now. That's all I have to say.
Thank you, Si. Any other members of the board have anything to add? No? All right, so at this point, we have, I guess, addressed concerns, raised concerns, heard from the public, and I think what's left is to update some of the information. Several board members will be in attendance at the Board of Selectmen's meeting on Tuesday to hear the Selectmen's take on the proposed loading and unloading area. But I think the next order of business is to continue this hearing, and we should do it by motion. I think because of town meeting and some closed dates that we've left December 15th, which is actually the hearing close date, open to continue this hearing until. Right, so before we move to continue the hearing, do any of the board members feel equipped to begin a discussion regarding conditions or any of the waivers involved in the decision? Do we feel like we have, and do we want to address some of those tonight, or does the board feel like we need to come back and do that on the 15th?
I don't know how we cannot start doing it tonight. The clock is ticking.
Well, that's true, but we've also heard some concerns from the board regarding members' ability to get their hands around some of those. So I would be interested in hearing from board members as to whether or not we want to start on to get as many of the conditions as we can on the record tonight, or whether or not we want to come back and do it in one fell swoop on another night. So I'm open to suggestions.
You mean another night after for the 15th of December?
The only other thing I'd add is procedurally, given where we're at, if the hearing were to be continued from tonight to December 15th, and then need to close on December 15th, that would complicate one step in this process, and that is that typically if there's a condition that the board believes it wants to impose on the applicant, and the applicant wants to assert that that condition is gonna render the project uneconomic, and therefore you can't impose it, they can come back and attempt to support that assertion. You know, in other words, once they say that something's going to render the project uneconomic, they need to show their work, and the board gets to look at it and see if that is, agrees that that's so. If there's something the board had in mind in terms of condition, and didn't throw it out there until the 15th, the hearing would need to absent another extension from the applicant, the hearing would need to close that night without that back and forth. If the board is only going to meet tonight and on the 15th, and there are conditions that could potentially rise to that level, I think it might, and we want to go through that process. We need to flush that out tonight.
Go ahead, John.
I guess I'd have to ask town council. Do we still have a process through CHAPA now on the economic situations on the viability of a project?
In terms of having somebody review that?
Mm-hmm.
In my experience, the consultant that's available through, about through CHAPA, Mass Housing Partnership, the consultant that the board had in the early stages of the public hearing, in my experience, they do not review pro formas from applicants at the end of the hearing. But the board could engage to hire one on its own outside of that process. It just wouldn't be available for free from the MHP consultant.
Well, my thought right now is, okay, if we have to move forward and we're only going to schedule one more meeting, which I think is utterly ridiculous, I know we have town meeting coming up, I know we have a lot of things on the plate, we have to start somewhere if we're going to start here tonight. So where do you start? You're going to start on the number of units, the number of parking spaces. You're talking about... we don't have the specifics that I know of to talk about groundwater. We can't address that without specialists such as BPW and the town engineer. So we'd have to start someplace. So the only place we can start is the board going to accept the 72 units on the property. If the board decides not to accept the 72 units, regardless of what the number is, the developer's going to say, well, it's all over now because it's going to be economically unviable for me to move forward. So what are we talking about? Is this board going to say, we're going to give our ability to make decisions and try to balance what is being presented to the town tonight, to someone else to do, like a negotiator? I don't think the board's going to do that with only basically 1 month's worth of time to get this all done. And then you'd have to come back to the board and start reviewing all of those issues that you've talked about. So I guess I would go back to the developer and say, hey, look at where are you coming from? Where do you see us going? And what are your suggested solutions for ironing out some of these issues? Because you're taking notes. I think you can read between the lines, and you know that we have some problems here. How do we address that?
Bob Engler of SCP, I'm a 40B consultant. I apologize. I've been here. My son, Jeff, has been in that part. I've been doing this for 35 years. I've worked on Johnson Woods. I've worked on 175 towns, 18,000 units, and 150 40B. So I'm a developer consultant on 40B. I'm happy to answer that question. The way it works is it's a narrow window, but you have the window tonight because you can only ask for financial or formal review after you've finished all the other steps, which you've finished. We're not turning in anything new. You have everything that's been done. If you sit here tonight informally and say, we want a story about that, we have to respond and say, we can live with that or we can't. If we don't say anything, there's no pro forma review. If we say we can't live with it for economic reasons, you only have till the 15th of December. But that's enough time, in my opinion, even though there's only 2 to 3 people that do financial reviews. I've been doing it all my life, but I'm working for the applicant. There's about 3 people I can tell you they
position in time, and we can talk about it, so that on the 15th of December, they will come back and report to you and say, yes, this building works with one less story economically, and we can argue about it or not. If they agree with us that it doesn't work, you still have the right to say, okay, you'll probably lose on the economic grounds if we appeal to the Housing Appeals Committee, but if you have a health and safety or a local concern that rises to the level that trumps the need for affordable housing when we were on economic, you can still take off a story, but it has to be considered very significant architecturally as a local concern, not just you don't think it fits in, that's my opinion, it may not be yours, but that's the issue you and town council are going to wrestle with on the 15th. Can we still go forward and take the story off? I'm just using that as an example, or not, because we'll come back, and if we agree and yeah, we can afford it, then you can put that condition in. But I don't know that because I haven't been closely enough on this project to see whether we can live with it or not. That's an example. If you want to cut it in half, I can tell you right off the top of my head, it's not going to work. Okay? If you take off 5 units, well, that's not a lot of units, but a whole story, I don't know. We have to look at that. I've just gone through this, and we had 4 hearings going on in Brookline at the same time. All the issues are the very same one you're talking about. While I have the bully pulpit, let me just add something to Marky, okay? Because it was raised earlier. We just won at the Housing Appeals Committee last year in Brookline for 65 units with 0.17 parking because it was across the street from the Green Line. It was across the street from the train. The other four projects we have in Brookline are 0.65, 1, and something else is less than 1. So the numbers are coming way down anytime you're next to a transit-oriented development like that. So 1, in my opinion, seems perfectly acceptable and would be at the next level. But the second point, it's very clear to us, it was stated here, it's not a safety issue. It's the parking ratio is a marketing question for the developer, and if people don't want to, can't park their cars there, they won't rent the unit. So it's a marketing issue, not a town safety issue, because all the cars are going to be spilling all over the town. I haven't seen a single decision in 35 years. I could be wrong. It says that rises to the level of stopping the development because the ratio is wrong. I don't think a 1.0 ratio will carry the day. That's my opinion. I'll put it out there. But certainly the design issues can be raised. Everybody has a different point of view on design. And most people want it to be less. We have to argue that we can't afford it. And that's the only thing you have left to do tonight, which is sitting at 15, is to tell us what you want very clearly but informally. What are the conditions? Because we're allowed to look at all the conditions together and say, does this render the project better or not? So it could be the story, it could be the parking ratio, it could be loading, it could be anything that affects us financially we have a right to look at. So that's what we'd like to hear, so we can then move forward. So your question, how do we move forward? That's my answer. Thank you.
Town Council. Yeah, I just want to follow up. Mr. Engler, I think I heard you to say that you're done. The applicant is done providing information, but that seems inconsistent. That seems inconsistent with what we've been hearing from Matt. You guys are in front of the selectmen on Tuesday. You have offered to keep discussing off-site parking arrangements. I mean, are you? So I just want you to tell us: are you done submitting information to the ZBA, or are we expecting more to come in?
Well, that off-street parking with the selectmen, I'm not, you know, kind of in that between. You know, is it we're done with plans? Architectural, civil, landscape. So from a planning perspective, we're done. The on-street loading for parking across the street is something we'll keep discussing. So I know. But it's also something that could be conditioned out. And I will just make quick points while I have it. When we started and we were 5, and you know, it is what it is, but when we got the corner, we reduced the number of units and took off a floor. We know right now that taking off a floor will be uneconomical. We're happy to go down that path, but we already know that for sure. When we did that, buy a piece for a large sum of money because it was a better project. That was, you know, we heard suggestions by many people in the town, get the corner piece, let's get the corner piece. Get it. You have to buy it. It doesn't come cheap. Parcels of land in a town like this. So when you do that and you don't add more units, you actually take units away, so and a floor away, we reach that point where any change could render it uneconomical. So we tried to lower it to the point where we were happy with it and we thought was a good point by taking off a whole floor, and we knew then people would all then just say take off another floor. So we've gone down that avenue. We're happy to continue to, you know, to show how that works, but we're confident that what we have now is where we consider it.
So your intention is to stand pat with what you have submitted, including what we have in front of us tonight?
I think the only opportunity that we had discussed, and this is more from a business standpoint, was the unit mix in the building. It, you know, you could certainly take some ones and make twos, and you could there could be some change to the unit mix. We strongly believe being on the train station, having the majority of one bedrooms, while may increase the number of units, actually is better for the parking ratio in terms of it meets that one, even better than if you had less units and a better ratio. We're very confident in that. But that is a discussion we've continued to have internally within the building parameters. It's in the same building, can we do, you know, a different mix of, you know, units between ones, two, and threes? That is a discussion we're willing to keep having. But we've had it internally, so it's not, you know, we're not hiding anything like that. We could have that discussion, but reducing a floor or making the building smaller, losing square footage, we are at that threshold now of it being an economic.
But I understood from what you had said back in October that the state, under the mass housing regulations, indicate that you need a certain number of threes and twos.
Threes.
So you're proposing no twos.
Twos are not an issue.
Twos aren't an issue. Okay. So now we have nine threes.
Yeah.
Well, we all know that when you have three bedroom units, you're going to have more than one vehicle. I mean, so if the minimum that you can put up there is eight, the question is, you know, how else can we move that and still make it an economical situation? And I take.
Well, I understand that the unit mix is after the Amesbury Supreme Court case. The unit mix is between the subsidizing agency and the applicant. They're saying they'll talk to you about it, but it's not something if you opposed it and they didn't like it, that would be an issue. But they're willing to say, if you want to talk about the ones and twos, more ones give you more units, but less demand on parking. So there's some kind of play back and forth, but it's not a big thing. It's marginal.
Yeah.
Changing. You could take out a three, right?
You could. The way the building was designed is just laid out that way. But we certainly can take that out, and I wouldn't be surprised if there was some minor changes to that unit mix. But we wanted to present what we have today. Well, it actually comes back to the economics of the situation. So I take your point very seriously. I don't know what else we can do but to get someone else in here to figure out. The only thing I can see on an architectural, we're not going to take off the floor. I understand. You know, in my mind,
that's just not economically feasible. But you could take off, you could chop off one end of the building, whatever that number of units are, to cut back and allow additional entrance. I'm not saying entrance, but I guess what I'm saying is you can diminish the density by architecturally taking off, as you count the rows, taking off three floors off whatever the number of, maybe they're all singles, and that is six units. What is six units? I don't have the plans. I didn't memorize the plans, so I don't know how that is. But if you take off the six units, is that still economically viable? That gives back some of the things like the loading zone. I mean, that's a safety issue, major safety issue in this particular community. You're right across the street from a very busy center for transportation in and out of Boston or wherever you're going. Is that an economical possibility? I think we really do need somebody out there to be able to work with the developer and say, what, I mean, you've heard parking, loading zone, density, open space. By chopping off so many units, you still make it economically viable. You're not going to reach your, I don't know what is it, it's no longer what, 20%, it's less than that now, in the new standard. But whatever the value is it still economically feasible, and we get something done? Because we know what Mass Housing is going to do. It has been doing this for the last 30 years?
69.
Pardon me?
It's 1969, it's longer than 30 years.
Okay.
And I started with it in 1969, so I don't know.
Okay. They're only concerned about one thing. If you don't have the minimum 10% low and affordable income housing in your community, we're going to force the issue one way or the other. You can either sit down and work with us to get it done, or we're going to blow you out of the water, the town of Reading or any other community, Brookline, Quincy, wherever you are, or Winchester, Stoneham, Newton, Wellesley, whatever. I mean, they are out there, and their demands are very explicit, and they'll go to court, and I just don't want to see the town of Reading penalized because we're not working towards that 10%. And regardless of how many other 40Bs there might be hidden in the pipeline, it's not going to work because the Mass Housing doesn't care.
Well, put it this way, the regulations state the date that this was filed, the comp permit last February, if you're under 10%, doesn't matter how many come in after that.
Exactly.
That's the data. So
yeah.
That's what
yeah.
the rule is. That's the law.
That's what I mean.
The question is, what can be accommodated? And that's up to you, gentlemen, to talk about.
And again, I will go, not to harp on it, but we started out at 77 units and 93 units an acre. we bought the corner. We didn't just come back and say, let's put 90 and negotiate down to a number we could live with. We came in, with the number we did the numbers, we ran them. Otherwise, we would have come back and said, we've got the corner, we want to go, we're going to do 93 units. No, and we had something wrong. When we did that and we talked to people, we said it's top dollar to buy land across from the train station in a great town like Reading. We believe that this adding people downtown is a great thing for downtown. There always is going to be issues on density and parking and all the other zoning things that you're seeking waivers on. But we really believe there's growth downtown, and for businesses to succeed, you need people to live there. And that was kind of our thinking on the one bed. So we came in with a number that we really was, where when we ran the numbers, where it hit that line of being feasible. Knowing that we were going to have this discussion at some point where people were going to say, take a floor off, take 20 units off, do this, do that. We continue to have a discussion of maybe the unit mix changes a little bit, but it's only because it's in the building changing a little bit, not because we're losing square footage in the building. And that's a good conversation that could be had.
Well, the fact that you move from multiple two-bedroom and three-bedroom mixed with the singles, moving all to singles, or virtually all to singles, was very, in my mind, very appropriate, only because of the parking and the other restrictions that you're asking for waivers on. But the waivers are not just strictly the density of the number of units on that site. It's other things. So how do we come together on this, all of this?
Well, let me comment on the waivers. The waivers go with the site plan.
Exactly.
And if they don't need them, you don't need them. But if a waiver is needed either to build a plan that's there or they can't afford it, I don't know if there's in a subdivision, if you said you've got to put two sidewalks down both sides and you only get one, that's an economic issue. But if it's a waiver required for the plan, it goes with the plan. If you take the waiver out, you can't build a project. So it becomes uneconomic simply because you can't build a project without the waivers being asked for. Unless there's a waiver in there, it doesn't relate to the plans at all, and that's worth discussing. But that's generally, the focus is what does the plan need, and that's why the waiver list is created.
There may be one, and there is a waiver out there that is very complicated on the lot shape. I do think the way it's written in the code is it is complicated to figure it out, but put it in there in case you needed it. There's a good chance now with that corner piece, you could really look at it and probably wouldn't need it, although I'm not 100% sure, but we'll really, take that out if it's not needed.
Well, Si, you mentioned, and I think perhaps we might even start with the list of waivers, or maybe just go down the list of waivers if the board is prepared to condition those tonight, then we should get that on the record and give the applicant an opportunity to know what we're conditioning for. If we're not prepared to speak on a specific waiver request, we can always table that, but let's get through as many of them as we can. And then perhaps if those waiver requests don't touch on all the conditions that the board would like to discuss, then we can do that at the end. But at least give some of the preliminary conditions, at least, or as many of them as we can. And I think the board is in a position to be able to do that. And even if we caveat some of it with, we're still waiting on additional information, for instance, the loading zone issue, that we table that for a discussion next time. But let's try to get through as many of these as we can. So I'm looking at the most recent draft page of waiver requests, not the one contained in the decision, because that wasn't the most recent list, I don't think, at the time the draft was, or at least wasn't included in that. All right, so everybody with it? I want to give the board members, everybody on the board have that handy? Mm-hmm. All right, so the first request from a waiver is, we'll just go through them by number. The first one is a waiver from 422 of the local zoning bylaw allowing for apartments in an S15 zoning district. And they asked for a waiver to allow multifamily dwellings in the apartment dwelling in the S15 zoning district. How does the board feel that?
I think if the project goes through, we're going to have to do it.
I mean, that's one of the most basic ones that we have. I don't think any of the board members are in disagreement. Do we want to vote on it? All right, I'll take a motion on waiver one for an S15 district.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor of granting waiver number one? Any opposed? No, that carries. All right, so that's approved. Waiver number two is table of dimensional controls, a waiver for apartments and lot size under 512 of the local of the Reading zoning bylaw. The Board of Appeals are asked to grant a waiver to allow multifamily dwellings on less than 100 square foot lot. Any discussion?
No.
If you're gonna do this project, then you're gonna have to go along with granting the waiver on that.
I mean, I don't think there's any way that this project works unless we grant that waiver.
Property
property is what it is.
Yeah, that's it. All right, I'll take a motion on that one.
So moved.
Do we have a second?
Just to make clear that.
So these are town council points out rightfully that these are provisional. These are not, how'd you put it? This is, we're basically polling the board on whether or not the board feels that these waivers are acceptable.
Mm-hmm.
Perhaps maybe doing it by motion is not the way to do it, just if we agree that they're acceptable. Go ahead, Chris.
Yeah, no, that sounds fine. You're not voting to actually grant the waivers until we vote the final decision at the end of the process. So, right now, I think it's helpful to get a sense of the board as to whether these, the board's agreeable in general.
So the board, so rather than withdraw the motion, on number two, the board's agreeable to granting, provisionally agreeable to granting that waiver. Doesn't seem like the board has an issue. Julie, that's up there?
Oh, no, I'm good.
Okay. Number three, table of dimensional controls for apartments, maximum building height under 512. The requirement is 35 feet. Request is to grant the waiver to allow 48.4 feet. Is that still the proposed building height?
Yeah, there's a little bump in right at the corner that's up a foot and a half, or a couple feet. I think before it said 45, but there's that little parapet.
I thought I read somewhere 49.4.
No, it ended up being, I'll confirm that it came at 48.4, but...
That's the highest point?
The highest point is the parapet, yeah.
Well, how can we, that should be conditional. It should be 45.2, except for that.
Right, so generally agreeable to grant that waiver at 45.2 with one parapet at 48.4. Pending further confirmation that that's all right.
Yeah, I don't think we're going to get it below the 35 feet.
No.
The town zoning, so.
No,
yeah,
clearly not.
I mean, something we're going to have to live with.
Waiver number four, off-street parking and loading and unloading requirements, requiring 1.5 spaces per unit. And the applicant is asked to grant the waiver for, and I guess, you know, the amount of spaces at this point is 72 total, according to this request for waiver, so that's one space per unit. I think we've all mentioned and voiced concerns with a one space per unit, and I think we ought to discuss what type of a condition we want to put on this. I mean, that, you know, generally we'd like to see 1.5. Is there another number that we can live with that we want to hold the applicant to? Because it's clear, at least it's pretty clear from our discussions, that one is probably not the most desirable.
Well, 1.1, you're talking about 7.2 spaces more.
Well,
if you talk about
if we talk at one and a quarter, 1.25, I think that's an additional 13 or 14 spaces.
Yeah.
They have 74 on the current plan.
Okay.
And so 1.25 would be an additional 16 spaces.
Okay, so if at 74 spots, an additional 16 spaces at 1.25. I'm sorry? Well, I mean, whatever 1.25 works out for the final number. Do we think that, I mean, I'm all ears. I mean, if the board wants to condition at 1.5, we know what we're going to get back. But, and even at 1.25, we might still get pushback. But it's something that we really need to condition on before the applicant gets a building permit, I think. I really don't think that the town is best served by a one-for-one.
Well, you've already talked about looking at additional discussions.
Off-site parking.
Right. So if that's still in the mix, I think everybody would be in agreement that the 1.0 is just not appropriate. Something else approaching 1.25 or whatever is certainly something for discussion purposes, which the developer, you could talk to the other individuals out there. I don't know how you work with MBTA or whatever for those nice spaces and how that all works out, but if this is something that we can discuss, I would say instead of putting it up there for discussion purposes, making it the 1.25.
Well, I think we, if we're going to ask the applicant to adhere to it, we need to come to a number. And
but,
so
but we're not
it,
voting.
It would be a,
we're not voting.
No, we're not voting on it, but I think that the applicant gets a flavor for where we're going with it.
We need a sense, not just one or two members, we need a sense of the majority of the voting members to tell us what we want. We have a right to consider that and come back to you.
Right, right.
So
right.
That's fine. I would just encourage you that you had a peer review traffic consultant, as I understand it, they didn't talk about parking ratio. If you want to call them, because the Hopkins Appeals Committee listens to professionals in the field. If you had one on your team and didn't ask him what's a decent ratio, I think you should ask him. He may agree with you, and he may not, but I think that's useful information. Not from our side, we have our own traffic consultants. We hired one. You ought to pick up the phone and ask them what they think, what they have for experience with the studies. Useful for us to know, too. They're not going to call, but you guys.
Thank you for comments. We're going to ask town council to weigh in and chime in.
I'd have to go back and find the exact language, but the original traffic peer review report, or maybe the civil peer review report, asked the applicant for more information, actual, I believe, real-world information to back up the traffic count, the proposed traffic numbers. And I believe the board's been asking for more information on to support the traffic, the parking.
The parking. Yeah. You asked, what's the scope for your peer review? I didn't see it.
I'm saying the peer reviewer raised this as an area in which the board needed more information.
Yeah, we provided it, but I think there's clearly opportunity. We hope to have some other spaces in town, but we know that's a process. And that won't change the parking ratio in the building per se. But we're more than happy to say 1.5 is required, 1.25 with a Haven Street, those aren't utilized, but if there was a number that said, we're happy to look at it, I don't think, it may, even 1.1 may render it uneconomical, but at least we have something to go back and kind of see if we can make work. So.
Well, what do we think about 1.25, not just on site, 1.25, 1.25,
in a combination
utilizing off-site.
I think that's great, and we'd be more than happy to figure out with the town how to, whether rent spaces or whatever it may be. But I think that's a process that wouldn't get, even if it was in place to do something like that, I don't think it could happen quick enough. But we're more than happy to, and we've been actually trying to have, we've been having those discussions with the town, because we knew it would be something that would be,
thank you. We would condition it before you get a permit. There's a number of things that you're going to have to go through before you're going to get a building permit, before you're going to get a demo permit, before you're going to get a foundation permit. So there's a number of discussions and things that you have to go through. During that time, the board would be looking for a commitment fee to get to a certain number, and we haven't decided what that number is yet. We've bandied about 1.25, but I haven't heard from much of the board that they're in agreement with that number. Before you got it done, before you put a shovel in the ground. That would be something that perhaps might give you something, something to shoot for during that time period. I haven't heard from, so that's where I'm coming from.
Yeah.
Go ahead, sir.
Mr. Chairman, the issue I think for the developer is not before the building permit, but before the appeal period runs on, they have to know they have a commitment from other off-site spaces to get to that ratio, whatever it is, because if they don't appeal and then they come back at the building permit stage and say, we couldn't meet it, and we're in violation of the permit, they can't wait that long. So I don't know if they can get that done between now and the next, until January, whatever the final appeal period runs out. They have to get commitments for what your ratio is. It may be possible. I'm just raising it as an issue that it doesn't take. You can't go to a building permit stage because they can't wait that long to know whether they can do it or not, unless you say best efforts. And you don't say absolutely or violation if you don't get 1.25.
I understand that, but let's also not forget that we've been talking about this since February. It's been an issue since February, and to suggest that now there's a mad dash at the end, just like there is with everything. Mad dash at the end renders things uneconomical or unfeasible. I mean, you know, so let's let us make a determination as to what we think,
sure,
what we think we want to impose, perhaps.
Okay.
And then if there's further discussion or further information that needs to be shared on the issue, then I certainly think that's a viable option as well. Sai, what you know, I'd like you know, John and I and Robert, I think, have weighed in on that in some respects, and I'd like to hear from you and from Kathy as other voting members.
I would certainly go no less than 1.25.
Okay. You know, certainly Nick and
Eric,
I'd like
something
to hear
higher, but I'll go along with the 1.25. Likewise for me, but I would go along with the
1.25.
All right, Nick.
I'm actually okay with the 1-to-1 ratio, but I am concerned about the applicant's suggestion is almost going to be a self-governing parking system. I would like something a little bit more solid, whether it's assigned spaces or something that manages and mitigates the overflow of the tenant parking from this project onto the town streets at night.
Thanks, Nick. Eric, any thoughts?
I'm comfortable with the 1.25. But this hard deadline that we have for December 15th, maybe town council can chime in, but that can be voluntarily extended with the applicant?
Absolutely.
Okay. I mean, I would definitely suggest that if the applicant's open to that, that the parking issue probably won't be resolved, even on Tuesday with the selectmen, if you wanted to push it out a month or two. I think that would give us enough time to rectify that. Obviously, you know, keep harping on the parking. I know that you're looking to make a development that works for you guys, and we're still in the give and take section. I don't think we need to threaten going to the housing appeals court or anything like that. I think we can still work this out, but we probably just need a little bit more time. And I know that we've been very charitable with our time and extensions. Maybe we could do the same.
That's fair. And perhaps we can have that discussion as we get a little further down here, down the list as well. I think it's a point well taken, and something we certainly might want to discuss. From the members and primarily the voting members, it looks like we're looking at 1.25. So at least keep that on your back burner for waiver request number 4, 1.25 spot.
Could we also contact peer review specialists for traffic and parking or whatever, and see what he comes up with, so it gives us a little bit more ammunition down the road? I mean, we have a number we're shooting for, but I know you're at 1.0, and we don't have any more information from our own peer review specialists. So I'd like to hear from the application too, if that's all.
I'd have to go back and reconstruct exactly what the last thing the peer reviewer said is, but the peer reviewer, thus far at least, hasn't offered, I don't think, an independent opinion as to what the right number, amount of parking would be. They've merely looked at the original amount proposed by the applicant and said that there is not enough information in the record to conclude that is adequate to serve this project. So my sense as to where the board's at in terms of the information in the record is that, you know, I don't believe that there is, this is the board's determination, but there's not a lot of information in the record from the applicant to directly support the parking counts that have been proposed.
Perhaps the proposed condition of 1.25 spurs a little bit more activity in that. Let's see what comes. All right, let's move on to request for waiver number 5, off-street loading and unloading requirements for an apartment under 9117 of the Reading Zoning Bylaw requires one space for every 20 units. requesting a waiver. We've seen the proposal. This is the proposal that's due for discussion before the board, Board of Selectmen on Tuesday. As we've at least generally made some, had some discussion that where it might be a private concern seeking some exclusive rights on public land, that's a determination, you know, some sort of an easement or some sort of a grant of right, that at this point that that's squarely in the Board of Selectmen's court. However, do any of the board members have any commentary of whether or not they would support or think that a loading zone on the public way is warranted? Go ahead, John.
I'll go on the docket and say definitely I'm opposed to putting it on the town-owned property. The right-of-way is the right-of-way. I've seen too much of this before. Again, in the urban areas, every time you have something like that, what are we going to do? Every time there's a move, you're going to get somebody, you're going to get a police detail for that area. Every time there's a move, who's responsible for all of that? All these questions come up. So I think it's a major safety issue in terms of what we grant as a waiver. The one space per 20 units, I understand what you're asking for. You're asking for a large unit, one large space, and one smaller space. But I think that ought to be on the grounds of the project. But I think since we're going to talk about it with the selectmen, I think, you know, right now.
Yeah, I mean,
table that until Tuesday night.
Well, I certainly think I would just want to get a flavor from the board as to whether or not it was something that the board would support.
Okay.
If the selectmen support it. I mean, it's a new proposal, relatively new. You know, we haven't gotten any feedback from public safety on the issue, whether or not. You know, I imagine they'll be in attendance at the Board of Selectmen's hearing and might be asked, certainly would be asked to weigh in on that. I think, you know, I look at it as a public safety and you know, traffic issue as well. And in addition to the private use of public lands issue, which is why this guy gets the big bucks. All right, so I think we probably want to table that for discussion following
I would just make the comment. I would agree with John. I'm opposed to any loading areas using town property. Any loading areas should be done. That should be done within the facility.
All right. So, go ahead, Matt.
Just to clarify, we aren't seeking exclusive use of that. It's not though. It's not something that says only for the built applicants here. I mean, you see those spaces in town, and this is one of the, if not only, bylaw that I actually see it as voting for apartment buildings, and it is there. But you know, I also don't think it would rise to safety level. Where there's on-street parking already. I mean, otherwise it's just regular on-street parking, or it may actually be safer than other spots on the property, which we heard when we had that discussion with the peer review consultant. We had it on our property. And because you're on the corner there, no matter where you pull in off-site to it, it's not an ideal situation. So that's why we took it away from in front of, we moved the building around and put it in front of the building where it also needs to be in a space that would be properly used, and, you know, front, rear, near, exit, and entry.
How would you make it non-exclusive to the project? You're going to let people park there and you're going to say, oops, we can't let you.
The town bylaws allow the selectmen to designate areas as loading zones, service zones, they call it. So just like there would be in plenty of places, it's just a designated service zones like you would usually see for places, commercial plate parking from this side to this side. So, well, you know, it is in front of the building. It wouldn't be exclusive if there was something being delivered across the street and they had no place to park, there's a loading zone there. You know, it's not exclusive. We're not asking, saying we can only be the ones that park. We may end up, it may appear that you'd be the only ones to be there, so we're certainly not asking that it's exclusive for that building.
Okay. I look at your plan and I think it's the space that's designated for loading is too small. I don't see how you're going to fit a. It looks like it's maybe big enough for a box truck. I don't see how you're going to put a moving van in there. It's one space. It's 25 feet long, 30 feet long. How are you going to put a moving van in there?
There's two spots, one's 30 and one's 18.
Well, the other one is designated as a, what, service? You have to read, but, okay, so you have somebody using that to be moving in, then you're going to have a FedEx delivery or an UPS delivery, then you're going to have a mail truck pulling up there to build. That's what I'm thinking those spaces might be in front is for those types of deliveries. Peapod. Something like that, people coming in and they're going to be using that for the building. You can't have a moving van there and then not have room for these other service vehicles to use it. I don't think you have enough room.
The demand that you think the loading to the moving, well, the initial must be, there's some, once that happens, it's really minimal in terms of the amount that the moving. Trucks are going to be used. It'd be more common for whether it's like a van for the elderly or a Peapod or something like that to use those than a moving truck to be there parked on there all day.
I would tend to think if you're going to have a moving van there with the sides open on the van, the back open on the van, four movers moving furniture in and out of an apartment or whatever, I would tend to think you might need a police detail on that.
This will be discussed on Tuesday night.
Yeah.
Chris, you had something perhaps to add to this?
Yeah, just a comment about where we're at procedurally. Given where we're at procedurally, if the board as a whole seems inclined to deny the waiver request, which would have the effect of requiring an on-site loading zone. It ought to signal that tonight that it is so inclined, because what that'll do is it'll tee up the applicant's ability to say no, that's gonna sink the whole project economically and show their work on that. So I would suggest that if this is a big issue and it appears that it is, that the board tee that up. I don't think that would necessarily prevent the applicant from going in front of the selectman on Tuesday and seeing what it can do there. But just in order to evaluate the effects of requiring a loading zone, we would need to sort of throw that out there tonight.
Well, the difference in the waiver being requested, the waiver says four. Right now, you want a waiver from and make it only two, but on public land. So we're reducing it already, so that the question is, do we want everything on site and still give you a waiver? The answer would be individually from board members what they want to do. Personally, I think it should be on site. But that means that out front, you're talking about additional parking spaces and whatever, you're getting additional parking spaces out front if you're not using two of those or the equivalent of three or four of those for loading zones. So I can't see Mass Housing deep sixing the project because we're requiring the loading areas on site. I don't see that as being a killer.
Point of clarification subject to Chris.
I don't think you're voting on the where they go offsite at all. That's the Board of Selectmen. You're
right.
Saying we have to provide four by zoning code or whatever number you want, on site or not at all. Laboring to say we can't do them on site. So that's the only thing you're doing. Offsite, whether the selectmen allow it or not. Now, if you say no parking, no loading on site, the selectmen will hear that and say you don't want to allow, I mean, you don't want to waive anything. We don't have any ability to do that. So that's really two different things.
So I think at the risk of stating the obvious, it appears that the board poised to deny the off-site location on street of a loading zone. Am I misstating that? Any other members of the board?
No.
Okay. So I think just, you know, in the interest of keeping good notes, I think the applicant now on notice that the board is poised to deny, request for waiver number five to the extent that it's off-site.
Procedurally, I think that, based on discussions with Chris, wouldn't be a waiver on the city of the board. It would be a waiver on providing one off-street loading space for 20 units. So I think the one on providing it off-site becomes under the purview of the select. And so I guess the question is, what we're saying is we can't, there's, without changing the building and losing units and space, we can't provide any loading spaces off-site that the peer review consultants recommended to be approved. So that's why we switched it back. So we could certainly entertain looking back to putting it where they were, but it was against the peer review consultants' recommendation.
Well, this comes back to the question I asked at the very beginning. Who has the final say?
We're more than happy for you. I'm just as confident that loading zones on apartment buildings will not trump the need for affordable housing under 40B. But we are not, we don't have, unless we change the building or put it on the front, which we explored, and the peer review, and that was for one, not four, but the peer review consultant didn't recommend it go there. Unless we move the building and change the building and lot part of the building, we wouldn't be feeling it on site. So we thought a good middle ground was putting it, wrongly seems, on the new curbing we'd be putting on the street right there. That's currently now just a big curb cut where it is, and thought that would be the best way to utilize it since it's also right in front of the door. But that was something that, you know, isn't our, you know, we have to go to the either your board or the selective.
Well, I think we'd be appropriate to wait until Tuesday night and argue this issue up with the selectmen, or, I mean, this is, if we're trying to get through the list of waivers, we're...
Yeah, let's see what
my take on this is as follows. The Board of Selectmen may have the ability to authorize the use of the road for as a service zone. But this board needs to, until this board waives the zoning requirement, this applicant needs to provide on-site loading zones. So both things would need to happen. So I said before that you couldn't authorize, you weren't the right board to authorize the placement of the loading zones in the street. But in order for those to go in the street, they need to get out of the requirement that they'd be on the site in the first place. So there's, I think, two things need to happen. I'm not explaining it well. I hope that makes sense. You would need to waive the on-site loading requirement, and the selectmen would need to approve the placement of the loading zone in the street. Both would need to happen. And to just to touch on Matt's point, it may well be that the requirement that you put at least one loading zone on site would render the project uneconomic, but we can't, you know, we need to see some work on that. We can't accept that just as things stand tonight.
The statement was more to meet the code. It says four. So, that clearly is, you know, meeting that requirement of 3.5, however it gets calculated, because 1 for 20. So, if you're saying one, that's a different story than saying you need to meet the requirement of the four.
Yes, and in this board, in, yeah. in all its decisions over the years, have waived, given variances or special permits other than what is in the zoning code. So by minimizing it or lessening it, the condition was, it's a condition to the, what we're calling waivers, but for us it's called a variance. So we're minimizing the requirement for four on site, and this board may decide that it needs one on site, period. But that's still a waiver, but it's not the waiver that you're looking for. So this is what is the issue that needs to be.
Correct. And if you said one is something we could live with, we could see and look and see if there's a way that could make it work without rendering an economical thing we have to prove. But at least we knew we had a number, like just like you had the parking, and at least we knew we had a place to go back and look and then have that discussion. Well, we also will go to the selection too. We think that clearly is still the best place for it. We'll look at both situations.
I think we've exhausted discussion on that.
Right, that's what we're looking for.
Oh, you're looking for a number. Oh, okay, I see. But I don't think that's...
It's going to be difficult to give a number because I think, as David said, I think one loading zone would be adequate if it were large enough. You don't need to have five different loading zones, you know, one for each, for 20 units. You had one loading zone on site for the units. Might be a 40 foot, for a 40 foot trailer, for a moving van. So it might be 40 feet by 15 feet. One might work. But we want to see, at least I would like to see, I want to see an on site loading zone. Here.
One.
I'm not going to give you a waiver for not having one. Period.
That's okay. we're still, if that renders it uneconomical because we can't fit, you know, one
well,
on there.
I don't know.
Yeah.
But that's a public safety issue. By not having that.
And you could still have one on site. The reality is, if it's not located in the right spots, people may not, you know.
So then you're going to make it work?
Yeah.
We're not going to tell you where to put it.
So is the request that we look for one loading space on site?
But that isn't the request at all. That was a suggestion. I'm saying, come up with something.
I'm certainly not going to support
a waiver for no on-site loading zone, period.
And the answer is no.
That's the request, to have no loading zone on site. That's the request.
And we will look at putting. We did look at putting it on site. I think staff could attest that we had discussions with the peer review consultant regarding a space on site. Where we put it at that time, they didn't recommend. So that wasn't. So we'll still look at it, but it also has to be a space.
Well, they're saying no. Let's just look at that.
You're not going to alter the no here. Let's move on.
All right, so now we're on to number six, traffic and parking regulations. I think this is where it falls. Location of bus stops, taxi cab stands, and service zones to be specified by the Board of Selectmen. And this is where we get to the issue before the Board of Selectmen on Tuesday. The waiver is to allow two on-street service zones in front of the building, one 30-foot zone for loading, and one 16-foot zone for transient parking. I think this is the one that comes squarely, this is more squarely viewed as under the purview, at least for now, under the Board of Selectmen, and we ought to table review based upon what the Selectmen have to say. Agreed?
Agreed.
Number seven is off-street parking design. Drive aisle under 9122, 26-foot aisle widths. The proposed aisle width is 24 feet. Bob, you confirmed that earlier via some commentary.
Yep.
Do we have any discussion from the board on the aisle width request?
No,
I think, I don't think anybody's
saying it's sufficient. 26 is required, but 24 foot is acceptable.
I think it can work.
I think it can work, right. All right, so at this point, nobody's raising an objection to number 7, and it seems there would be a consensus to grant that one. Moving on, number 8, site plan review under 433. The applicant is requesting a waiver from any separate site plan review under 433. They've already done the peer reviews. They're going to need to go through the final design review anyway.
This is part of the whole process.
I think it's fine. I believe that's in there for like if CPDC we're going to review it.
Yeah, I think 433 is CPDC.
Yeah, I think it is.
They're going to need it anyway.
Yeah, I think it's fine.
This process is effectively stands
Right, that's what I mean. So I think the board is inclined to grant that request for waiver under 433. Number 9, table of dimensional controls for apartments, maximum lot coverage. The requirement is 25%. The applicant has requested a waiver to allow 71% lot coverage. With existing lot coverage at 32, proposed open space 18, and existing open space, oh, sorry.
That changed
to 57% and open space 22%. Any of the board members have commentary on the lot coverage?
Well, this is where it gets touchy because if the loading zone has to go on property, it's going to affect the open space aspect of it. If they're going to change the scope of the or the size of the building in any way, it is as it is right now. It's before us, so it's something that we're working with. So I think you have to go with it for now until you come up with a final, because we don't have finals on any of these.
It's conditionally okay, depending upon several other aspects that are still open to review, I guess. So am I hearing that the board is generally okay with that, pending further?
That's okay with
that.
Yeah, I think so. All right. Yes. All right, so
I mean, it's going to be what it is, what it is.
We're inclined to grant that waiver, you know, pending, you know, I mean, this process is sum of all its parts, so. On to number 10, table of dimensional controls for apartment side setback under 512. The requirement is 20-foot side setback. Waiver request is for a 15.7 foot setback on the side yard.
Does that change to 16.7?
I see 15.7. Is
that? Yeah, but I mean on the updated one, I thought it was 16.7. Yeah. Seven bolts down.
16, yeah, I have 16.7 on that too. That's the draft decision though.
Yeah.
Okay, don't go by that.
So that could be a typo.
That was before we
submitted the revised. Right, so it's 15.7. Correct? Yeah. Any commentary by board members on the 15.7?
Again, we more or less accept it.
Well, I mean, when you're accepting the lot coverage, you're
right,
essentially accepting the
The rest of the dimensional controls.
Yeah, the dimensional controls.
By reducing it, it's not a public health and safety issue.
Right. So the board is inclined to be in favor of that. Again, taking all these as a whole, assuming that the numbers stay relatively close to with regard to lot coverage and open space. And that may change depending upon what else might end up on site.
You're doing that basically with 10, 11, and 12.
Yeah, so we've got 11 is, well, we might as well read them into the record, John.
Okay.
Number 11, table of dimensional controls, front setback under 512, the requirement is 15 feet. The applicant has suggested a waiver to 5.8 feet, same as number 10. Number 12, table of dimensional controls for apartments rear setback, 512 setback is required at 20 feet. The applicant has requested 13.8 feet, again, same as the prior two.
So the ones that were issued in the draft are incorrect.
Yeah, those are all outdated.
So those are outdated.
Yeah, don't go by the draft.
So it goes back to the 5.8 and the 13.8.
Yeah. Right.
We submitted a waiver request instead, so just wasn't, the draft hadn't been updated.
Yes, yeah. I'm reading from the current. Okay. And the decision didn't take that into consideration, the draft. Number 13, we've kind of discussed this. Does the applicant want to withdraw its request for a waiver under a peculiar lot shape?
So you can tell me how to calculate.
It's something you may need to discuss with the town.
I really was having a hard time actually calculating.
I think you would have. Yeah.
I think we should come close to complying. I think we comply now, but
I think you do too.
We'll take. I'll double check.
Double check.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. So even though it's almost a moot point, it seems like we may have some zoning bylaw changes anyway that might render it. We ought to at least give the feedback on it since you've asked for it. We ought to keep it on the record. So under waiver number 13 for lot shape 521, request is that waiver be granted to allow a geometric shape that's less than the lot area. And the board is inclined to go along with that since you're going to be in compliance anyway once the probably at some point.
I think it is. It really is a complicated.
The board doesn't have an issue with it anyway under that waiver request. Number 14, water connection permits. The request is that a comprehensive permit in lieu of local approval, as are required to obtain a Town of Reading water connection permit and a waiver of other charges not provided for. We can take 14 and 15 collectively because one is water connection and 15 is sewer connection. Does the board have any thoughts of that? On that, I have some thoughts. I mean, our inclination is to perhaps to not grant that. However, what I think I've heard suggested or discussed or somehow became aware of it is that the applicant that the waiver be granted only as it relates to the affordable units, so that they don't have to spend money on water connection permits for the affordable, as it relates to the percentage of affordable units, but the market rate units they're required to get water and sewer connection permits. So basically, it's reduced by 25%. And as such, it's kind of a give and take. So while we're saying, yes, you're required to have a connection permit, that's the take. The give is that it's not applicable to the affordable units.
No, is that
the 25% units designated as
affordable. Why? I would like to hear an argument why it isn't. Why? Just because they were affordable units, you're going to waiver a permit for the sewer connection? And it's, we're not talking individual sewer connections here, each unit. You're talking one sewer connection from the whole development. complex, right?
It's just it doesn't tie to the units, but it ties to the 25% to provide the affordable housing and the cost of doing so. It's typical of the town to waive the 25% or 20, depending on what the mix is, just as a cooperative thing. You know, there's no rationale other than the economic value of doing that versus
I'm getting the opinion perhaps that the board might not necessarily be in favor of that concession. So
I don't have a problem with something like that.
Well, I guess
it needs to be part of the entire package.
Let's perhaps, you know, maybe we put the cart before the horse. I would like to hear from the applicant as to why they feel that.
I know from dealing specifically with cases on it, it's a standard that any agency and everyone will adhere to. Nonetheless, I think part of that waiver was also sometimes there's a condition you need a separate water connect. It's conditioned upon getting a water or sewer connection. And it would be a separate permit we'd have to get from another board, which we're asking because we went through. It's not the fees, you know, you still have to pay, there's INI fees and all that stuff. It's not a waiver from that. But it is, I've run into it where there's a condition that says you need to then go to the water and sewer department and get a separate, they have, like a hearing and give a permit, which we're asking for a waiver for, because it's a separate board that you would. And that's why we heard testimony and get peer reviews on water and sewer and have had comments from the town engineer. So that was part of that waiver request that I'm sure town council can speak on it.
Well, there's two parts of it. They give me a grant that we can address for the government.
Right. Yeah. And we there's still INI and all that, you know, fees we have to work and work out the actual construction. It's not like saying you deal with it. It's the detail of the construction, how it's done, but the actual connection granting is done. That's a compromise. So
I understand what your argument is. Number one, the INI's got to do with the sewer connection, it's got nothing to do with any water connection.
Right.
Okay? INI is you're paying a separate fee to counteract the additional sewage that your, or wastewater, that your project is putting into the sewer system to counteract inflow and infiltration on that. So you're paying a separate fee for that with the town. And this is a fee just to connect to the sewer.
Right, no, I was trying to separate.
Yeah.
Maybe I didn't make the separation clear. When they're asking for a waiver from the connection permit, you don't go to water to for actual the approval for the connection. You go for the design. They will have separate rules and that we have to follow, such
right.
as I. Separately, on the the connection fees, we've asked for a waiver for the affordable components, the 25%. So just generally a standard. And if you're saying no, we'll have to go back and look at it. But that's it. Every 40B I've worked on, that's just been a standard that's been around.
Matt, we're talking about the cost of the permit program, correct? Not the usage.
The waiver is from obtaining separate water connection permits and associated charges. It was at and for the affordable units, but it's also from getting that they
should be two waivers.
Yeah, I'm saying right.
Well,
it probably should have been two waivers.
Then I think the board needs a little bit more time to let this one sink in. So I think we're going to table discussion on these last two for the continuance. All right. Well, we made some progress. Yeah, we should put on the record that Reading doesn't have a water and sewer department, so it's, you know, it's the, you know, it's the DPW, you know, the town engineer that, you know, probably work collectively on what you're looking for. So perhaps we need a little bit of clarification as to exactly, you know, how that might work before we can give you a full and fair.
Because it's not referencing
yeah.
any bylaw.
No, right, exactly. So, I mean, we know what you're getting at. You kind of know what, you know, let us know. Yeah. All right.
I volunteer to look into that.
Julie's going to look
into
that.
Yeah, I'll look into that.
All right. Is there anything that we haven't touched on that we ought to touch on? We made some progress, at least. Gave everybody some food for thought. All right, so the next hearing date, and again, we started to talk about this a little bit before we got into the waivers, but we're holding December 15th open, and that's the date that the hearing's got to close anyway, so the applicant okay coming back on December 15th?
Yeah, I mean, obviously I know town meeting's coming up. We're more than happy to come back that day.
Yeah, I mean, that's pretty much the next available date. We don't have meeting dates available before that because of town meeting and some extensions of it. But we did set the 15th out because it coincides with the date the hearing has to close. You okay with it?
Yes.
Okay. All right. I'll hear a motion from a member of the board to continue the hearing till December 15th.
Go ahead. And I just want to make it clear for the record. I think it's already out there. The board appears poised provisionally to deny waivers 2 and 5, if I have that right. Waivers 5 and 6. So if the applicant wants to respond to the signal denials of those two waivers on the grounds of economics, please be able to do that sooner rather than later, because we'll need to not just see it, but see it with adequate time to respond to it prior to 15.
Because we can work with staff and the council on that specific
but issue. Given that neither the board nor staff, I don't think, have the ability to independently review what I expect you'll submit, we will need that, I think, almost immediately in order to be ready for the 15.
So actually 4, 5, and 6, because we've talked about a conditioning for 1.25, so we've at least thrown that out. And then 5 and 6, well, 5 is the one we've denied, and 6 is the one that's going before the selectors. So 4, 5, and 6 is generally, you know, and then 14 and 15 we've tabled.
Right.
Right. Just to be clear, so everybody understands. Okay. Everybody all right with that? So we've got a motion to continue until December 15th. Do we have a second?
I'll second.
Robert, all right. Any discussion on the motion? No, all
yes.
those in favor?
Discussion.
Sorry, go ahead, John.
We have hearings coming up on the 3rd of December, right?
December 3rd? No, we don't have any December. No, this is the first meeting in December.
I'm pretty sure the 3rd is a weekend.
No. It would have been the 1st, and that's the one that's set up for town meeting.
The 1st has been canceled.
Right, we don't have a meeting in December. December 15th is the first meeting in December.
Just, okay, are we through town meeting by December 8th?
No.
You know, rather than getting to the 15th in the last minute, I'd rather try to do another session like we're doing right now on the 8th, if we can fit it in, so that we can get closer to where
I know the Christmas is coming up soon after, but I don't know if the 22nd and meet the 15th and the following week on the 22nd, in case the board, if it needed to have an extra week. I know that's probably tight with schedules.
But then so is the 29th,
and then so is this.
Yeah,
so
40
days.
Yes.
I mean, you have 40. There is
40
days to do the decision,
but
we want.
But the issue is what you brought up already, and that's the economic viability of 4, 5, and 6 before even after Tuesday, are we talking with the selectmen? So
if we'll get an answer to you within a week.
Okay.
And if we say it's uneconomic, we have to give you a budget to close with that, and then we'll tell you where you can find out who to hire and get that person on your agreement. We have to pay for that. And have that done before the 15th. There's a lot of work. We'll get an answer if we can live with it or not. That's our obligation to give you a budget to go with that.
Okay.
You okay with that, John?
Yep, okay with that.
We've got a motion to continue to the 15th, and we have a second. All right, all those in favor? Any opposed? No. All right, we're continued until December 15th. Thank you, everybody. Hearing is adjourned.
Motion to adjourn?
So moved. Second?
Second.
All those in favor? All right, now we're adjourned.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.